Good evening. Today we will discuss about hexose monophosphate pathway under carbohydrate metabolism. In cell, some or other activity is going on all the time. It means in order to sustain those work, cell require energy. And that energy keep coming from glycolysis. So in glycolysis, glucose molecule is converted into pyruvic acid. As a result, two net ATP are formed, and those ATP are used for performing work by the cell. In case of rapidly dividing cell, or in case of cell going for oxidative stress, this glycolysis pathway is diverted. All the biochemical reactions in a cell, they are well regulated and they are well controlled in a way so that need of a cell can be fulfilled. For example, when energy requirement is there, glucose molecule is oxidized into pyruvic acid, the process what we call glycolysis that we have discussed in one of earlier lectures. And in case of cell going for division, like in rapidly dividing cells, or a cell is going under oxidative stress, the glycolysis pathway is diverted. So in case of rapidly dividing cells, this glucose 6-phosphate, instead of going for glycolysis, it enters into hexose monophosphate, or also called as pentose phosphate pathway, where it is used to synthesize ribose 5-phosphate plus NADPH. So this pathway is called hexose monophosphate pathway, where ribose 5-phosphate and NADPH is synthesized, and along with these two products, fructose 6-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, these are another two product of hexose monophosphate pathway. So in case of cell requiring NADP or ribose 5-phosphate, this pathway stops at here. But if ribose 5-phosphate is not required by the cell, these product or another product, fructose 6-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, they enter into glycolysis. Fructose 6-phosphate enters at the second reaction, so it can be used in glycolysis. And same time, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is another product of HMP pathway, it also enter into glycolysis to give energy. Or if energy requirement is also not there, these two, fructose 6-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, they are converted back to hexose sugars like glucose or glucose 6-phosphate. So pentose phosphate pathway is also called as pentose shunt or hexose monophosphate shunt or phosphogluconate pathway. It occurs in cytosol, and in this pathway, glucose 6-phosphate, this is converted into ribose 5-phosphate and NADPH. NADPH is a nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide phosphate in reduced form. So these are two major products of glucose 6-phosphate. These are two major products of pentose phosphate pathway. This ribose 5-phosphate is used in synthesis of nucleotides like DNA, RNA, and several cofactors where nucleotides are involved. And NADPH is used for reductive biosynthetic reactions for fatty acid synthesis, steroid synthesis, cholesterol synthesis, and additionally, it also helps in preventing oxidative stress that we'll discuss in later slides. So glycogen is converted into glucose 1-phosphate with the enzyme glycogen phosphorylase. and this glucose 1 phosphate is converted into glucose 6 phosphate with the help of enzyme called phosphoglucomutase. So this glucose 6 phosphate can go into three ways. When there is a need of energy by the cell, it can enter into glycolysis, can convert into pyruvate or lactic acid, or pyruvate in case of oxidative reactions, pyruvate can be converted into carbon dioxide and water. Or glucose 6 phosphate, if glucose concentration is low in the blood, so this glucose phosphate will be converted into glucose in liver by glucose 6 phosphatase, and this glucose is poured into the blood so that blood glucose concentration can be maintained. The third fate of glucose 6 phosphate is pentose phosphate pathway, where ribose and NADPH, these two major products, are formed, and these are required in rapidly dividing cells where biosynthesis of nucleotides or nucleic acids, cofactors, fatty acids is going on. So for that you require ribose and NADPH. So basically pentose phosphate pathway gives ribose 5-phosphate and NADPH, which are further required by rapidly dividing cells or cells undergoing oxidative stress. This pentose phosphate pathway is also called a shunt because two of its products are glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and fructose 6-phosphate. So these two products, they can enter into glycolysis, or even from the depending on the requirement of the cell, from glycolysis, these glycolytic intermediate, they can enter to pentose phosphate pathway as well. So that's why it is also called a shunt. Its intermediates are linked, products are linked to the intermediate of glycolysis. So this pentose phosphate pathway is an alternative way of glucose consumption. It consists of an aerobic and an anaerobic phase. You also call that oxidative phase or non-oxidative phase. In oxidative phase, glucose 6-phosphate is converted into ribulose 5-phosphate by dehydrogenation and decarboxylation reactions. As a result, two NADPH molecules are also synthesized from two NADP+. And the ribulose 5-phosphate is further converted to ribose 5-phosphate, which is required for biosynthesis of nucleotides, coenzymes, nucleic and DNA, RNA nucleic acids. But if a cell doesn't need synthesis of RNA and DNA, or ribose 5-phosphate is not required, in that case, ribulose 5-phosphate, the product of this pathway, can enter into non-oxidative reactions. Those reactions are catalyzed by two enzymes, you call them transaldolase and transketolase, and those two enzymes convert this 5-carbon ribulose 5-phosphate to glucose 6-phosphate, which can again enter to the pathway and can give rise to more NADPH molecules. These NADPH molecules, they are required for synthesis of fatty acids and steroids, and also these NADPH also help to regenerate, reduce glutathione from the oxidized glutathione with the help of enzyme glutathione reductase in order to tackle reactive oxygen species in the cell that we will be discussing later on. So there are two phases of reactions in HMP pathway. The first is oxidative reaction phase, where in the first reaction of oxidative phase, glucose 6-phosphate is oxidized into 6-phosphogluconolactone, which is catalyzed by an enzyme called glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase, and this is a regulatory enzyme of this pathway. And in this reaction, one molecule of NADP+ is reduced into one molecule of NADPH and H+ ion. This enzyme glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase is highly selective for NAD plus only. The Km value for NAD plus is 1000 times greater than NAD plus. It means glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase binds NAD plus 1000 times more stronger than NAD plus. And the activity of this enzyme is regulated by concentration of NADH in the cell. The second reaction of oxidative phase is hydrolysis of 6-phosphogluconolacton to 6-phosphogluconate, catalyzed by lactonase, where one water molecule is utilized. And in the third reaction is again a dehydrogenation reaction catalyzed by 6-phosphogluconate dehydrogenase, where 6-phosphogluconate is converted into ribulose 5-phosphate, which is a pentose sugar. Same time, the first carbon of glucose is removed in form of carbon dioxide. And simultaneously, another molecule of NAD plus is reduced into another molecule of NADPH. Now this synthesized ribulose 5-phosphate pentose sugar is converted into other pentoses by epimerase and isomerase reactions. So in one reaction, ribulose 5-phosphate is converted into xylulose 5-phosphate with the help of enzyme epimerase. And this ribulose 5-phosphate and xylulose 5-phosphate, they are epimers. There is a difference of single group, hydroxyl group, at one carbon position. If you see there, these are called epimers. So the reaction is catalyzed by epimerase. In another reaction, ribulose 5-phosphate is isomerized into ribose 5-phosphate by enzyme called ribose 5-phosphate isomerase. Now these pentose sugar, they react with each other into non-oxidative phase of HMP pathway. So in non-oxidative phase, one molecule of xylulose 5-phosphate react with ribose 5-phosphate, and the reaction is catalyzed by enzyme called transketolase. So transketolase transfer two carbon fragment from xylulose 5-phosphate to ribose 5-phosphates, and that's why it produces 7 carbon sugar called sadoheptulose 7-phosphate. And the leftover from xylulose 5-phosphate, it forms glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. In another reaction, these two products will react with each other in the presence of another enzyme called transaldolase. Transaldolase transfer 3 carbon fragment from this 7 carbon sugar, sadoheptulose 7-phosphate, to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. As a result, you have a 6 carbon compound, 6 carbon sugar, fructose 6-phosphate, and a 4 carbon sugar, erythrose 4-phosphate. In the third reaction of a non-oxidative phase, these two products, they are acted upon by transketolase, again the same enzyme which catalyzed first reaction. And transketolase transfer 2 carbon fragment from xylulose 5-phosphate to erythrose 4-phosphate, and that's how it produces another molecule of fructose 6-phosphate and one molecule of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. These are extensive carbon reshuffling reactions. There is no energy requirement or energy gain for these reactions, and only two enzymes catalyze them, transaldolase and transketolase. Transketolase require thiamine pyrophosphate, TPP, as a cofactor for this enzyme, which is also synthesized from vitamin B1. And transaldolase has a lysine side chain in the active site, which transfer these three carbon fragments from one substrate to another substrate. And a genetic defect in transketolase, which can lower affinity of transketolase for its cofactor TPP, that is related to Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, because if transketolase doesn't bind TPP effectively. These reactions, they do not proceed in normal directions, so that there is accumulation of their substrates. As a result, a medical condition arises that is characterized by memory loss, uncontrolled movement of eyelids, and vision change. And that's also called Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. So if you summarize all these non-oxidative reactions, we see that 5-carbon ribose 5-phosphate react with another 5-carbon xylulose 5-phosphate, and you have a 7-carbon compound, 7-carbon sugar and 3-carbon sugar, which are again acted upon transaldolase to have a fructose 6-phosphate 6-carbon sugar released from the reaction, and the leftover 4-carbon erythrose 4-phosphate react with another molecule of pentose sugar, xylulose 5-phosphate, to give rise to another molecule of fructose 6-phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So in this pathway, in one cycle, you have 1, 2 and 3. 3 pentose sugar which are reacting with one another, and they are giving rise to 2 molecule of fructose 6-phosphate and 1 molecule of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. These fructose 6-phosphate, they are converted back to glucose 6-phosphate. Both are hexo sugars. But in case of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, it is a 3-carbon sugar. So to convert that into hexo sugar, you need one more molecule of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So that's why two cycles proceed together. So in one cycle, the one product glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate react with product of another cycle, which is also glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, to form one molecule of hexose sugar. So in that way, there are 6 molecules of pentose sugar which react together, and they releases 5 molecules of hexose sugar in form of fructose 6-phosphate. So inside the cell, if concentration of pentose sugar is very high, these are all reversible reactions which are occurring in non-oxidative phase. So if in cell there is a high concentration of pentose sugars, so these pentose sugars, they react with one another through the transaldolase and transketolase enzymes, and they give rise to hexose sugars. So this hexose sugar can be used for oxidation in glycolysis to give rise to ATP if there is a requirement of ATP, or they can be converted into glucose and can be stored as per the requirement of the cell. So these reactions under non-oxidative phase, they are reversible and they depend on the relative concentration of their product. If glucose 6-phosphate hexose sugars are high in cell, in that case, these reactions, they all are reversed. So they can give rise to pentose sugars, which can be used for biosynthetic reactions. Pentose phosphate pathway is regulated by the first enzyme of the pathway, which is glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase. This enzyme is regulated by concentration of NADPH in the cell. It also produces NADPH, is one of the product of this enzyme. So if NADPH is sufficient in the cell, in that case, the pathway doesn't require to go on. So high concentration of NADPH inhibits activity of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase. In fact, it's a ratio of NADPH and NADP, because NADPH is not an allosteric inhibitor of this enzyme, it's a competitive inhibitor. It means NADPH binds to the same site where NADP plus binds. And that's why high concentration, because it's a competitive inhibition, so in that case, whichever out of NADP plus or NADPH will be in high concentration, that will bind to the enzyme. When NADP plus is high in the cell, It means NADPH is less. In that case, the reaction will proceed. It will activate the reaction. If NADPH is high in the cell, in that case, NADPH will bind at the site where NADP plus bind, and that will inhibit the reaction to proceed. The another mechanism of regulation of pentose phosphate pathway is the reactions which occur under non-oxidative phase. All these reactions which are catalyzed by transketolase and transaldolase enzymes, they are reversible in the nature. So depending on the concentration of products, for example, if you have high concentration of pentose sugars in the cell, it means they are not being utilized in biosynthetic reactions. So in that way, the cycle will proceed in the direction to synthesized hexose sugars from pentose. Or if there is a requirement of pentose sugar in the cell, these reactions can go into opposite direction so that more pentose sugars are available. So relative concentration of these sugars, pentose and hexose, that determines whether this cycle is going to backward direction or forward direction. In case of a rapidly dividing cell, which require more ribose phosphate than NADPH. So as we know, in biological systems, all these pathways, they are demand dependent. They depend on the need of the cell. So in this case, when cell require more of NADPH, ribose 5-phosphate is not required. So in that case, all the reactions, they proceed towards production of ribose 5-phosphate in high concentration. So in case of a cell which is requiring more ribose 5-phosphate than NADPH, so all the reactions of HMB pathway, they shifted towards production of ribose 5-phosphate. So fructose 6-phosphate and glyceryl 3-phosphate, which are produced in non-oxidative phase, they enter into the reaction catalyzed by transaldolases and transketolases, and that's why more concentration of ribose 5-phosphate will be produced in the cell. In another situation where the cell need NADPH and ribose 5-phosphate in a balanced manner, both are required, in that case glucose 6-phosphate will be converted to ribulose 5-phosphate using oxidative phases, oxidative reactions, which is converted into ribose 5-phosphate. So these steps will be more preferred. When a cell require NADPH and ribose 5-phosphate more, this ribose 5-phosphate will be consumed. So more glucose 6-phosphate will be converted into ribose 5-phosphate and more NADPH will be produced. So the demand for NADPH and ribose 5-phosphate, they both are taken care of by the cell using this pathway of reactions. In another case, when more NADPH is needed than ribose 5-phosphate. So this is the situation when a cell is going for oxidative stress to neutralize reactive oxygen species, cell require more NADPH. So in that case, the cycle will be shifted so that more NADPH is produced. So what will happen in this case, the ribose 5-phosphate which is produced from HMP pathway will give rise to fructose 6-phosphate and glyceryl 3-phosphate using non-oxidative reactions, and these two products, they will enter into glycolysis in a reverse manner. Reverse manner means these reactions of glycolysis, they are reversible in nature. So when you have high concentration of glyceryl 3-phosphate, for example, and dihydroxyacetone phosphate, instead of going for production of pyruvate in glycolysis, it will be a synthetic reaction for fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Similarly, when you have high concentration of fructose 6-phosphate, so the reaction will proceed for synthesis of glucose 6-phosphate, like what happens in case of gluconeogenesis. So that all these intermediates, they proceed to produce more NADPH in the cell, so that the demand of NADPH is taken care of by the cell. So increased concentration of glucose 6 phosphate will give rise to increased concentration of NADPH and so on. There is another situation when cell need NADPH and ATP both. ATP comes from glycolysis and NADPH is from HMP pathway. So in that case, glucose will enter to HMP pathway instead of directly going to glycolysis, so that NADPH is produced, because cell need NADPH. Then ribose 5-phosphate will be produced, but this is not required, so that it will enter into non-oxidative phase, will give rise to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and fructose 6-phosphate. And these two products of HMP pathway, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and fructose 6-phosphate, they will enter to glycolysis and get converted into pyruvic acid and give rise to ATP. So in that way, the demand of cell for NADPH and ATP both is managed. NADPH is used to get rid of reactive oxygen species, and in this process glutathione plays a major role. Glutathione is a tripeptide formed by glutamic acid, cysteine and glycine amino acid. So it's a tripeptide, is also ECG, it can be said as ECG. E stand for glutamic acid, C cysteine and G glycine, and these amino acids are bound together through peptide bonds. And there is a unique feature of this peptide, that is the first amino acid glutamate. There is a unique nature of this peptide, that is the first amino acid glutamate is having peptide linkage with cysteine through its side chain carboxylic group. In normal cases, you have alpha amino group reacting with the alpha carboxyl group of another amino acid to give rise to peptide bond. But here side chain of glutamic acid is involved in peptide bond formation. So this is an example of isopeptide bond, where instead of main chain carboxylic and amino group involvement in peptide formation, you have involvement of side chain group of glutamic acid into peptide formation with the cysteine amino acid. So this is reduced glutathione, is also called GSH. So this reduced glutathione is oxidized by an enzyme called glutathione peroxidase. This glutathione peroxidase help to remove H2O2 from the cell. H2O2 is oxidizing for the cell and is unhealthy. So H2O2 is converted into H2O by glutathione peroxidase. In turn, glutathione is oxidized into GSSG, oxidized glutathione form, where two peptide of glutathione, they are linked together through disulfide bond of cysteine. Cysteine side chain contain SH group. So these cysteine from two molecule of glutathione, they are oxidized together to give rise to oxidized form of glutathione. So that is the use of glutathione, reduced glutathione. Reduced glutathione help to get rid H2O2 from the cell. But this oxidized form of glutathione is converted back to reduced form by enzyme called glutathione reductase. And this is the enzyme which utilizes NADPH in order to reduce oxidized form of glutathione, so that this oxidized form can be again used by glutathione peroxidase enzyme in order to remove free radicals from the cell. So in fact, this is called a detoxification reaction, what glutathione is involved into in a cell. For example, in case of in RBC, there is a highly oxidizing environment, because oxygen bind to hemoglobin and oxygen molecules, they are also get converted into superoxide anions. So these superoxide anions, they are acted upon by superoxide dismutase enzymes and is converted into H2O2. This H2O2 is responsible for oxidative stress in the cell, because accumulation of H2O2 in the cell It leads to hemoglobin denaturation, formation of Hinge bodies, membrane lipid peroxidation, and a disease called hemolytic anemia. So when H2O2 is there in high concentration in RBC, it oxidizes biomolecules so that biomolecules are cross-linked together. Those cross-linked aggregated biomolecules, they are seen like Hinge bodies in RBCs. And these cells, they get ruptured, they get lysed. And after lysis, the urine of a patient where the reaction is occurring in is become dark black in color. If H2O2 is not taken care of, if H2O2 is in high concentration in the cell and is not being reduced into water, that's what happens. But in normal situation, H2O2 is converted into water by enzyme called glutathione peroxidase, which is a selenium containing enzyme. And this enzyme, it uses two molecules of reduced glutathione in order to catalyze this reaction. So it means glutathione, reduced glutathione is required to remove H2O2 from the cell. But this reduced glutathione is produced by glutathione reductase, where oxidized form of glutathione is converted back to the reduced form. And this glutathione reductase enzyme use NADPH, which in turn comes from pentose phosphate pathway by oxidation of glucose 6-phosphate with the help of enzyme glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase. So in case if there is any problem with this enzyme, glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase, for example, its activity is not there or its gene is mutated. So in that case, sufficient amount of NADPH will not be produced in the cell. As a result, sufficient amount of GSH, reduced glutathione, will not be there in the cell. And as a further result, glutathione peroxidase will not be able to convert H2O2 into water. So in that case, H2O2 will be accumulated in the cell, will cause oxidative stress, and it is responsible for a condition called hemolytic anemia. So this hemolytic anemia is occurred by ingestion of oxidative agents that can generate reactive oxygen species. For example, anti-malarial drugs like primaquine or even fava bean contain a compound called purine glycoside. So by ingestion of the drugs or the fava bean, that can lead to high reactive oxygen species in the cell. So in such situation, if a person is having deficiency into glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme, so in that case, that lead to hemolytic anemia. Because these proteins are cross-linked in presence of H2O2 in RBCs, and eventually the cell lyses, and that causes hemolysis and hemolytic anemia to the individual who is having a mutant of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme, which is not active. This situation is also called as favism, because initially it was known that people eating fava beans with also having deficiency of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase, they have this situation of hemolytic anemia. So it was also known as favism. Even Pythagoras was having this problem there. He was having a G6PD deficient genomic structure. That's why could not digest fava beans or even any compound which is responsible for production of more reactive oxygen species. So in that case, erythrocytes, RBC, they use to lyse and they create the situation, what you call favism or hemolytic anemia. And there's another interesting fact associated with the individual who have deficiency of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase in the tissues and cells. Those individuals are not infected by malarial parasite, because due to deficiency of glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase in their RBCs, their RBC environment is highly oxidative, and malarial parasite, it cannot survive that oxidative environment. In fact, malarial parasite also required reduced glutathione in RBC to survive. And because the patient, these people, they are having deficiency of this gene, this enzyme which produces NADPH, in that case even malarial parasite is also not able to grow in the cell, and that's why they are not infected, they are not shown symptoms of malaria even after infection of the parasite.